My name is Anne-Marie Davis, and I am the Japanese Studies Librarian at The Ohio State University Libraries, and I am an associate professor. So these scrolls are two scrolls, and they're in a really nice wooden box held at the Billy Ireland Cartoon Library and Museum. They were created in 1921 by a group of about 18 key manga artists that were hired by Tokyo's top newspapers of the day. And so they created these scrolls that focus on the 53 stations of the Tokaido route. They're really historically important, and for people who want to study the history and evolution of manga in Japan, they're absolutely critical. I did this project originally with Josh Savari as a type of GIS story map. And as I was doing this, I was telling my colleagues across North America, other colleagues who are in Japanese studies librarianship. And so we decided that we would, wouldn't it be fascinating to create a digital exhibit that explored kind of the connections and the history of these lesser known works that reflect kind of the national celebration of the 53 stations across time. Another reason we focused on these scrolls was because I've been working a lot with the East Asian Studies Center, OSU's EASC, because they have a whole package of K-12 teaching materials on the Tokaido Road. And so this was a really great opportunity to bring that story map together with actual images that we could share with teachers and the public.
The request to digitize these scrolls came to us from Anne-Marie Davis. She had been able to get a part of the scrolls digitized a few years ago, but there were more that needed to be done, and she wanted to have a complete representation of all four scrolls. The scrolls are somewhat unique for us in that they are each 30 feet long. They are stored rolled up in boxes, so they're never flat. We can carefully roll them out to make them flatter, but that takes some intervention. And the scrolls needed careful handling because they consist of illustrations done on individual sheets of paper, 27 to 28 illustrations per scroll, with delicate attachments in between the pieces of paper. So the handling had to be extremely careful.
What I ended up doing was taking a look at the scrolls with Amy, and she identified the areas that she was concerned about, which the scroll is made up of several different images. A lot of the splits were happening in between each image, where they had been pieced together, and just over time and handling, they were coming apart. So that was really what I did, is like any other paper repair we do as a conservator, using Japanese tissue, which has long fibers, but it's very thin, so it doesn't add a bunch of bulk. The fibers are very strong. We use wheat starch paste, which reacts to humidity and moisture the way that paper does, very similarly. It ages well, and I was able to lay those scrolls out and mend all the little tiny tears and splits between images doing that. The challenge was there were four scrolls and I needed to get them all done in under a week, so I had two tables laid out with one scroll on either side. So at one point I had all four of them laid out, and I was mending one while the one across from it was drying, while the one on the next table was almost dry, and then the next one was waiting for the next mends. So it was a challenge.
Complicated digitization projects are always my favorite, because they require us to problem solve and try imaging setups that we haven't attempted before. And this was one of those projects. The scrolls couldn't be photographed on our usual photography table, which is only 3.5 feet across. The space around the table in the photography room is also small. So trying to manage the scroll in 3.5 foot sections with the rest of it hanging off at the sides would have been dangerous for the material and just impossible in the given space that we had. Luckily, the head of collections care agreed to make the collections care department available to us for a few days.
You know, initially we talked about getting, you know, these running rigs, and got pretty big, and we realized that a lot of it either was impractical or too expensive. So we kind of went with the more homemade options.
We were kind of debating whether we should keep the scroll stationary and move the camera overhead, or whether we keep the camera stationary and move the scroll below it. And there were a couple considerations that went into the decision, but ultimately it made more sense to do the platform. It just was a little more easy to do in-house. We had this 4x8 sheet of plywood. I did some researching online with some other people in the cultural heritage imaging community, and I kind of pieced together what they kind of did in similar situations. So I bought some V-shaped casters on Amazon, kind of like what you would have for like an overhead, like a barn style door. And then those sat on top of just some angle iron that we got at Home Depot. And we just taped those on the ground in parallel. So like create a little railroad track basically that it could slide back and forth on. And then once we had it squared to the platform and that was aligned to the camera, you know, just basically just sliding the platform, the scroll really didn't move very much inside of our imaging frame.
They wanted me on hand because of the size and having to unroll and re-roll and unroll and re-roll underneath the camera. The more hands, the better, and the more knowledge, the better. Years ago, I took a one-day workshop at not knowing when I would need this, if ever. So I took a one-day workshop with my colleagues at the Smithsonian Institution who taught care and handling of East Asian screens and scrolls. They taught me a lot of how to unroll and roll them back up, what kind of typical condition problems they have as they age naturally or from poor handling. So I was able to recognize a lot of that. And some of the trouble with those scrolls, because they're so long, when you start to roll them, they start to telescope out. You know, the edges aren't aligned. Like that happens with your wrapping paper in your closet. It happens with these scrolls just because it's paper rolling it around and around and around. So I was able to teach everyone how to adjust that as you roll, talk them about how to, when you get to the end, how do you get it straight again? And so we were all sort of learning as we go. And they were teaching me about image capture and how much of an overlap they needed. So we were both learning about each other's work as we were collaborating.
We kind of had to put the lights where we could fit them. And I rented two extra lights so that I could, instead of having to light from the ends of the platform being very far away, we could do it at basically the corners of where our imaging frame would be. There is some wave to the scroll. So the more light we have coming from more directions, it just flattens everything out and really makes it appear as flat as possible. You know, little ripples aren't going to show up because they're not going to have anywhere to cast a shadow from with four lights. So
in conservation, we're such a small and very specific field. They don't always make tools specific for conservators. So we often repurpose or misappropriate tools from other fields. We were trying to find a way to keep the scroll from rolling up on itself because it's used to being rolled all the way up. And when you get, especially towards the end of the scroll, which is the center, that paper is much more curled than the outside. And we were trying to find a way to keep it restrained so that it wouldn't curl back up while the image was being taken, but not so strong that it would tear or damage it. So what we had devised was a series of little weights, and the problem was the weights would have to be in the image. We really don't like to have any sort of editing on the images, like what is captured should be captured. So the knitting needles kind of fit into the crease at the end of the scroll, and then the weights sat on top of the knitting needles just out of the frame. So we were still holding it down, but had these nice little thin sticks, almost invisible in the image. So we were trying to capture as much of it as possible, and that was our solution.
Afterwards, it gets a little bit trickier too, because you know the item is designed to be viewed one panel at a time. So it's never rolled out in one big piece. one of the things that we worked really hard on doing was obviously we have our, you know, our master shot of each piece that is for archives. So that is you're getting all your detail as much as possible. We also decided there might be kind of a unique experience to try and do one file where it was all included in one big file. That is logistically hard because it's going to make a massive file. So I kind of took that part under my wing. It took me about 3 days to figure out the best practice on how to do it. We learned very quickly that Photoshop has the ability to create panoramics on its own. You give it the files, it'll, and we found that one, it was taking forever to do, even in just, you know, five panel increments, but also it was skewing things. So we ended up having to do each one hand, one at a time. And I had to come up with a practice for that. It took a while. So the ability to have it all in one big pan, because again, it's designed to be rolled, and even when you're looking at hand, and a museum's never gonna roll it all out like that ever too. So it was a fun way to realize when you had it all done, it's like, you know, this is never viewed this way. We had that ability to do that. So that was a fun part of the digitalization part of it too.
I started in this role in June of 2022, and I kind of heard about that they were waiting to be photographed pretty close to when I started it. So it was something I was waiting to work on since I started. I was like very excited to do it. So it was a real pleasure to work on. I think it went really well. And I think the end product really speaks for itself. Like it definitely achieved what we wanted it to do.
It had a lot, it was a lot more layers to it than just here's a thing we're gonna photograph. There's a lot of history to it. It was a lot of fun to document that. So, yeah.
In the process of getting these materials digitized, I had the opportunity to get to know them much better. And I had always known that our library actually has two sets, but I had never taken the time to sit down and study the two sets or really know exactly what that meant. But through this process, we were able to actually pull both sets out and realize that they're really unique in their own way, even though they belong to this kind of limited series that were available. I want to say that there are about 180 total. So it's a really unique opportunity to explore and know that OSU has two copies. And we made the decision once we discovered that they were slightly different to digitize both sets. And so this will be a really great opportunity for artists or historians or teachers who want to explore art and share with their students. A great opportunity for those folks to kind of compare and contrast the different pieces. There are other institutions that have these scrolls. They are distinctive. So they're not, you know, completely unique, but I think what is really unprecedented is that OSU does have two copies, and that through this process we've been able to really leverage that and share that with the public and make it available to research and teaching.